And today we have Mr. Vikas Gupta. I have known Vikas Gupta. I'd like just like to tell you how we met, because that is very interesting. We are both from IIM Ahmedabad, but he is 7 years my junior, although I think I look much younger now. He's got a long beard. Several years. So I did meet about him. I was involved with Lacoste. And as you can see, if I can stand up, I have proudly wearing one of my Lacoste t-shirts made at the Lacoste company, Lacoste India, here. I was involved along with Mr. Amit Judge in bringing the brand to India. And this brand was launched. And for several years, it's of course a very premium brand, and it did fine. But after several years, started waning, the profit, the sales flattened, the profits, it started losing money. And I was on the board of directors. So we had to take major action. And so we had to take major action, one of which was to let the current CEO leave at that time and to bring in someone new. So when Mr. Vikas Gupta was suggested and I looked at his CV, my first reaction was, what? You know, Lacoste is part of apparel. I've spent a lifetime in apparel. And I said, this Mr. Gupta is from Warner Lambert. Don't they make chewing gum? Don't they make chiclets? And he's going to run a company, one of the best known brands in the world, and run a company where we had production facilities, we had retail, we had distribution. Apparel is very, very tough in terms of merchandising. But of course, I was told that management principles are the same, whether you are making steel or whether you're selling garments or you are selling chiclets, among other products. And sure enough, we were, of course, kept our fingers crossed. But this is the year 2002. So Mr. Vikas Gupta took over as the managing director and CEO of Lacoste India. And he went about his job. Perhaps he'll tell you a bit more about it. I hope he shares some of those experiences. He went about his job in taking drastic action. And within a matter of 6 to 8 months, we started seeing changes. Within a year, we were again back into profitability also. Having said that, some of us find ourselves in business in hot water and we wonder, why are we here? Now, Mr. Vikas Gupta is one who looks for hot water and sorts out the plumbing of other people. He all of his assignments have been tough assignments, let me put it this way. Certainly at Lacoste, I know it was. He was there again for several years before he moved on as president of Polar, which is again international, huge company. At that time also, they had a lot of issues. And that's probably why they took on Mr. Gupta. And of course, he then went on to have his own entrepreneurship set up. He also found the time to write a book called Mindful But Absent, which is, I think, remarkable. And today, of course, he finds himself in ITC. And again, normally you think of ITC in terms of, once you're reached there, you're semi-retired. At least that's what I thought. I tried very hard to get a job in ITC. But of course, it was more, I thought I would remain happy throughout the life. But really, Mr. Gupta has taken on Bill's lifestyle, which was passing through difficult times. I was associated with Bill's, course, before, because Bill's lifestyle was one of our sponsors at India Fashion Week, and I was managing the Fashion Design Council of India. Mr. Gupta has a lot to share, and of course, he's cut his teeth in very difficult circumstances and turned it around. So if anything, he is the best person to speak about strategy and how to implement it. So over to you, Vikas.
I think it's my indeed privilege to be here today. And I think it is privilege on two accounts. One, you know, I have these youngsters on one side who I'm going to be sharing certain amount of experience with. And, you know, these youngsters are the future and they are going to navigate the world through, you know, these choppy waters. And when the world is actually facing an existential crisis. So I think it's a privilege to be talking to two students who are going to be navigating the world through these choppy waters. On the other hand, you know, I have you and Jerry sir and Sunil sir, you know, who are in their own rights icons that I really look up to, because you kind of redefined, re-mentioned. I read a book called 100 Year Life very recently. It's written by two professors in London Business School. And the book says that, you know, the life expectancy has gone on 200 years now. And therefore, we have to keep reinventing ourselves. And when I think about that, and I see the way you reinvented yourself, Vinod sir and Sunil sir, I mean, it's a privilege to be associated with you. So overall, I think I see surrounded myself with opportunities in this session, and therefore I look at this as a huge privilege to be talking to be here today. Now, I've been given the task of talking about strategy. So I put together a few slides from the presentation. And I find during the course of my 30 years of work and 50 years of life, I don't know where is the presentation now. So I have seen that, you know, the word strategy is pretty liberally used, and it's always a good idea. Sometimes it can get very intriguing, and sometimes it can get downright intimidating. Having gone through 8 businesses now, you know, I have come across various situations where, you know, a lot of jargon was thrown into the strategy statement. And I think one of the tasks that was required is to kind of de-jargonize it, make it really simple list of actions to do. And the aim of my presentation today is to just to walk this group through about some of the work that I have done along with some amazing teams. And, you know, while Mr. Paul talked about a lot of output that he saw being produced in the past, but I think I've been really privileged to have some really amazing teams in every assignment who have actually done the work. All I have done is, as leadership our team, is to try and facilitate that work. And some of the instances that I'm going to walk you through today, hopefully when the presentation comes online, is going to be trying to make it clear to you that it's much easier to sort out a business and attain a desirable result if you are not jargonizing the matter and we're trying to keep things very simple and having an executional focus around it while taking care of all stakeholders. So essentially, I'm talking about three things. That one, it is a list of few things which are correlated with each other, which is called a plan. The second is that, you know, there must be an executional focus. And last but not least, it has to work for everyone. If it doesn't work for somebody, then, you know, it's going to be always difficult for the overall plan to work. I think I will need some help to get the presentation. So basically, when I started looking at it, I said, let's look at what some of the big stalwarts have said about strategy. So let's say some of them think that it is a plan. So, you know, the Flip Kotler, who is supposed to be the father of modern marketing, he says there is only one winning strategy, which is to carefully define the target market and direct a superior offering to the target market. Typical marketing speak, jargon laden, but conveys the message very clearly. And the one which is my favorite is when your headlights aren't on, the best rear view mirror isn't improve your drive monitor, improve your driving. Then something that Mr. Nair referred to the other day on Monday when he was talking, the purple cow strategy, which is fitting is a short-term strategy, standing out is in the long term. Then something that Pablo Picasso said, that our goal can only be reached through a vehicle of plan. There is no other route to success. And you would recall that while Picasso is known for being being an absolutely wonderful artist, but many people may not know that he contributed to the art of that time through his new concept of cubism, which was the most influential art movement of the century and has continued to actually be so. And cubism was nothing else but trying to look at any situation from multiple angles. So it's important to really remember, you know, these are the kind of things that people said. Steve Jobs, who doesn't know it, when he was told to do cost cutting, and I specifically included this because I will talk about this in context of the cost that that, you know, Mr. Paul introduced me first with. The cure for Apple is not cost cutting. The cure for Apple is to innovate its way out of its current cycle. So essentially, these people, and I have just chosen some of them, are basically saying it's a plan. Now, there are other bunch of guys, you know, who think it's nothing to do with plan, but it is more like an execution. You would all recall Jack Welch, who was the legendary CEO of GE, and he said, look, in reality, strategy is very straightforward. You pick a general direction and implement like that. So he was an implementation freak, and he wanted everybody to go after that plan and make reality, make his ambition become reality. He was there for nothing that it was called Neuron Jack. Then Sir Winston Churchill, you know, the wartime leader for England, and you know, his leadership style was punctuated by credibility, boldness, and eloquence. One of the reasons why he succeeded the way he did is because, you know, he had this terrific insight of just picking out the right thing and implementing like that. What did he say? However beautiful the strategy, you should occasionally look at the results. Now, who is saying this? Very ironically, a person who was extremely good with words. You know, his prime attribute was eloquence. So when he talks about results, which denotes numbers and outcomes, it's a little ironical. But and Charles de Gaulle, you have to be fast on your feet and adaptive. Alvin Toffler, my favorite. You know, you could have read some of his books called The Fifth Discipline. And, you know, Alvin Toffler, he was making predictions in the 19th century. Most of his predictions, one of his predictions was that internet will become big, data will become the king, cables will start roaming, genetic engineering will start taking roots and will, you know, reinvent humanity. Consumerism will become the centerpiece of humanity. Are all his predictions that have come true over the last 50 years of our existence. Therefore, he's become one of the biggest thinkers of the century. Now, one of his predictions that has not come true and was that cities, the demise of the cities, he used to say that cities will die because people will work from home. And funnily, today, as I'm saying this, we are working from home. And even the prediction that people say Alvin Toffler, actually only one of his predictions did not come true, today even that has come true. The last that I have chosen is Peter Drucker, who is the father of modern management. Plans are only good intentions unless they immediately degenerate into hard work. So basically, I have tried to take some of these to figure out what is a strategy. And my definition of a strategy is basically these three pillars. It is a plan with focus on execution, or you are trying to get people their jobs again, or whether you want to grow your GDP to $5 trillion, or you're just trying to stay the turnaround of the company, it has to result into a desirable outcome. So these are the three operating words around which I have actually completely modeled my presentation, and I'll give you some examples from my 30 years of work. To begin with, let's say it's a plan, and the underlying word plan, we're going to first focus on the plans. Then we'll get to execution and then we'll talk about winning a little. And it's 1 hour lecture, so I don't think we can get into too much of detail, but it's an overview at this point of time. Now, we will take a business context to begin with. And you can look at a strategy, as I started saying, you can look at a strategy for a single business. You can also look at a strategy for a cluster of businesses. A cluster of businesses like ITC. ITC has 14 businesses, and they are so structured that one business actually captures the value chain from the previous business, and therefore from one kind of raw material to the end consumer. There are multiple levers of the value chain that ITC continues. Let me give an example. before we dive into the individual and the corporate debate of so ITC, for example, does renewable forestry. So we grow our own trees. So we partner with farmers, we increase the farm income, and we get them to grow the trees. Once the tree reaches a level, then it does not sequester anymore. And that's a technical word. The meaning of the word sequestering is, look at a tree as an empty drum which absorbs carbon from the atmosphere. The moment it stops doing it, the technical word is that it has stopped sequestering, and therefore it is no longer that relevant for the environment. So then you can cut it, and then you can actually make pulp out of it. We do that ourselves, and the way we do it, we are carbon positive for the last 50 years of our existence. We are the only company in the world who utilizes 50% of our electricity in house. We have completely positive carbon footprint for the last 10 years. So we do not take environment lightly. So we grow the farmer income in a manner that does not damage the environment. So we take that pulp, we convert that into paper. And with that paper, we make cardboard, we make the packaging material for in-house. All our packaging, whether it's for any of our businesses, we do the packaging material ourselves. We also supply it to everybody, like Unilever, like Diageo, like everybody. We supply the packaging material made from the trees that we create social policy. And then we may also make notebooks with it and complex. Now, typically when you look at independent business, there'll be a paper mill which will buy pulp from somebody which will sell it to somebody else. You capture the entire value. So that is the difference between an individual business versus a corporate. And you can make also a correlation that it's about an individual. You can also have a success strategy for each one of yourself, which is a strategy for you. What do you want to do in life? Who do you think you are? Strategy for you. Similarly, a cluster of individual is a family, so you can say that I can also have a family, family trust, family HUF. But since this is an MBA school conversation, and therefore this is not an ashram, and therefore we'll talk about a business. And since it's an introduction rather than a strategy formulation and implementation course, therefore we would keep it to an individual business to keep the complexity of a strategy under control. Even though the idea is that you can have a strategy for anything. But those are the different levers that come the more and more complex it gets. So let's talk about simple one business enterprises. When you look at a one business enterprise, first thing you do, the technical term is you look at the value curve of the industry. Now, what does a value curve for an industry mean? It means what are the factors on which the competition takes place. And all factors lead to some kind of a consumer benefit. So let me give you an example about apparel industry. Since I work for two apparel companies, let me give you an example of an apparel business. Now, apparel industry is the second largest contributor to retail after foods and groceries, but it's the second biggest polluter after oil and gas. You know, it's a very funny thing that you may not know, but every pair of denim that you wear, utilizes about 1,200 liters of water. And that's a lot of water to be going behind one denim. And the consumerism is such that each one of us wants to have no less than at least 10 pairs of denim. Really indistinguishable from each other, but that is the level of consumerism. But that's the apparel industry. A slight competitive landscape, on the y-axis, you see the price points, which is bridge to luxury is something that is a shirt sells for about 5,000 rupees. Super premium is something a shirt sells between 2,500 to 3,000 rupees. Premium is a shirt selling around 2,000 rupees. And on the right two boxes that you see, which is the businesses like Marks and Spencer, H&M, Zara, Shoppers Stop, Lifestyle Future, Reliance Trends, Flipkart, Myntra, Amazon, the e-commerce guys. There's an arrow that shows downward, which is showing the further two segments are the popular segment. Popular segment is about a price point of 1,000 rupees. And the budget segment is below 1,000 rupees, all for a shirt. The size of the circle shows the size of that business. And you can see that the classic mindset is the largest market of apparel business. I wouldn't spend too much time on it, just a brief appreciation of the market construct. what are the industry trends? Then you look at the industry trend. What is the market like? And what are the trends driving that industry? The industry is very crowded and very fragmented. There is a proliferation of EPUB and white label brands. White label is, if you go into Amazon, you know, they have their own store level brands and they try and compete on the pricing. They give you a similar material than any other brand, but a little cheaper. You like the design, you like the material, and definitely, and it's a white label. Blurring of differentiation between brands, you cannot really differentiate one garment from another garment. And see now, buy now, disposable fashion, you know, I use something and I don't want to use it tomorrow, and my wardrobe is going like really, I need more and more cupboards every day, but I still go and buy. That's because, you know, I just buy on impulse. That's the industry trend. So this is what the current value curve looks like. So when you look at each of the curve, I've removed the brand names, right? But if you look at the quality, brand name, and the width of the collection are within the same range, meaning thereby that there is no purple cow, as Mr. Nair said the other day. So there is nothing remarkable about the difference in the quality or branding or the width of the collection. However, the entire competition is driven by, you know, who has more distribution points and who has the larger customer base. If you have an old business like Raymond's or Wipley, you will have 1,000 stores. If you are a new business like Napos, you will have 100 stores, and therefore you will have a larger number of customers or a few customers. This game essentially gets driven by price, and we will get to see the financials of some of the businesses, and therefore we will take a view on what kind of a business does it entail. But this is the current value curve of the industry. Then you look at, okay, if I want to change it, you know. Hello. If I want to change it, what are the consumer trends? No? And I see consumer trends are going back to the roots. The consumer is saying, look, I want to go back to the roots to rediscover consumer heritage. His share of wallet is going more and more behind other categories like consumer electronics, like gaming, and he is trying to be more conscious about inclusivity, sustainability, authenticity, things like that. And everybody is more relaxed. You know, I wouldn't have been having this conversation without a jacket, but I can have it now. Today, a Puma shirt, a nice white polo shirt is acceptable garb. You still can't come in shorts like this, but you know, there has been a little bit of relaxed and natural look in this space. And then empowerment and individually comes in, and fitness is a big trend. So if these are the consumer trends, what do I do? What are the actions that I can take to improve my performance? So let's say this is what I can do. I can reduce a few things, like I can reduce the regular fit offerings. I can raise a few things, like I can raise the local ethos in the communication. I can make a hiccup shirt. I can make, you know, a bundi, for example. I can make iconic product which resonate with the local sentiments. I can eliminate a few things, such as synthetic blends, because they are harmful for the environment and they are harmful for the skin. And I can create differentiated experience by launching different stories, trying to create a DIY, which is do-it-yourself kind of a training, and trying to use technology like augmented reality and virtual reality to create experiences. Now, these kind of things engage the community. These are the levers that I have with which I can actually draw a new value. I can do a few new things. When I do that, this is the new value. So few new dimensions get added. And then the entire competition starts happening on value, not the price. Now, this is important for everybody to understand. Now, a thinking cap, we are not going to get into it. You might want to draw a similar value prop for any of these industries like cola, retail, airline, ed tech companies, computing, e-commerce, personal transportation. And I put these down because there is some interesting work happening. When you try and draw value curves for these industries, you will find value curve. And if you can identify those things, you know, it will be very interesting for you to figure. So going back to my original slide, when you look at trying to make a strategy for your company, you have to first look at the value curve of the industry, which we have just finished doing. Just give me a feedback that it's clear and, you know, understood, so that I can go forward. Right now, it's a monologue. Is it is understandable? Am I going too fast or is it okay?
It's okay, sir.
Awesome. So now the next thing is whether the industry is attractive or not. Now, this is a very important aspect because when you get into an industry, you need to be seeing whether, you know, what is my financial expectation? What am I getting for? Now, typically you see that the trading margin that you expect. Now, trading margin, some of you will be commerce students, you will understand what the trading margin is. Some of them will be engineers, some of them will be other disciplines. So let me just tell you, the profit, let's just call it of a company in relation to its sales, expressed as a percentage, could be 5%, could be 10%, could be 20%, it's called the trading margin. So the trading margin, let's say your expectation from an FMCG business is 20%, right? So if you're an FMCG business and you are delivering 20%, then you are in an attractive industry and you are meeting the expectations of an industry. If let's say you are an FMCG business, but your trading margin is 10%, then you are into an attractive industry, but you are a underperformer in an attractive industry. If you are an FMCG industry, but you are making 25% trading margin, then you are in an attractive industry and you are outperforming in that industry, right? So and so forth. So it's very important for you to understand what is the industry delivering for. So I have a few slides. Again, I'll continue with the apparel example because we started with value cover for the apparel business. The diagnostics part, I'll stay with the apparel business and then I'll move to some other industries just to make the conversation a little richer. So please look at the other financials. I've kept very few from an apparel industry. Some very interesting things you will observe. The first company, the FY1 is one financial year, FY2 is second financial year. Goal is growth over last year to show that, you know, whether it's a growing business or not a growing business, what is the size of the business. And PBIT is the profit before interest and tax, which is what I'm, for the purposes of this meeting, I'm calling it the revenue. The last two columns are retail turnover, which is the driver of profitability. Therefore, I've actually just included. So Keval Kiran Clothing Company is killer jeans. You know, you see that its turnover is about 405 crores. It grows by 10% and it turns in a trading margin of about 30%. When you look at the Indian terrain, 200-300 crore turnover, grow 22%, 15% trading. Now below that, you see Raymond Apparel, about 1,000 crore business, trading margin 5-3%. Monte Carlo, trading margin 9%. Zodiac, 200-300 crore business, making a loss. Shoppers Stop, Trent, Canterbury Leavitt, ABRL, which is Pantaloon, and Nagraga. All of them, the moment they get into 3,000, 2,000, 5,000 crore business, you know, look at the trading margin of 1%, 2%, 5%. What are the conclusions you get out of it? You should analyze it, you know, later, but you will see that until such time that you are a small business, 150 to 250 crore business, it is possible for you to make good trading margin. Why does that happen? It happens because typically when you are 200, 300 crore business, you are making one category. For example, Indian Terrain used to just focus on chinos. They used to just focus on chinos and they used to focus on Nordic. Keval Kiran used to make killer jeans. They used to only focus on denim, blue color denim, focus on SIS rather than having individual stores. They used to go to all stores that have a small point of sales, very focused business. So they were into a tough industry. Apparel is a very tough industry because you can see that nobody makes a double digit margin. So they were in a tough industry, but they were outperforming. In such time that they got ambitious and they started getting into Indian Terrain, started getting industries, other categories like shirts, trousers, jackets, so on and so forth, suits, and it got into trouble. So you have to keep this in mind. What makes you successful? And if somebody is outperforming an industry, what is it doing which is working for it? And those who are, you know, underperforming the industry, what are they doing which is coming in the way of desirable performance? So industry competitiveness is a very important thing to map. I can skip that, this slide. However, this slide just shows that, you know, there is a consolidation. When you have a troubled industry like this, the natural outcome will be that, you know, there will be consolidation. The bigger fish will end up eating the smaller fish, which is what is happening in the industry. And there is a lot of money that people make by selling their businesses and buying businesses in a hope that they will make money one day. But the people who continue to make money is the bottom line here. It's called the trade suppliers. So mills, artisans, people who provide the store services, people who provide the omnichannel services, planogram services, you know, are always in the midst of decent cash flows. Again, this is a thinking cap for you to work on your own subsequently. On the right-hand side are the attractive industries. On the left-hand side are the tough industries. Attractive industries globally. I have just tried to trigger your thinking. So globally, soft drinks is a very, very attractive industry. It's very profitable because it's completely owned by, practically completely owned by Coke and Pepsi. And it will be very interesting when you see this, what do they compete on and what do they not compete on? It will show very interesting insights about how it's almost like a duopoly when both of them compete. And they don't do anything to cut each other's profitability. It's a very interesting case study to see. So globally, software, pharma, spirits as in alcohol, these are very attractive. In India, tobacco, broadcasting, IT, ITS, reality, these are very attractive. Globally, the tough industries, airline, hotels, textiles are very, very tough industries. In India, edible oils, telecom. So, you know, you might want to say which are the outperforming firms and which are the underperforming firms. So try and fill up this grid in your free time to get your thinking juices going. So that's how you evaluate the industry attractiveness. Then you get to the firm. So you looked at the industry, what does an industry compete on? You look at what does the industry attractiveness, how to measure it and what to look for. And then you want to look at an individual firm. So when you look at the individual firm, let's say this is actually a Lacoste of 2002, which Mr. Paul spoke about. When I was brought in, this is what it looked like. So I haven't, you know, talked about what the turnover was, but let's say it was 100. The COGS was 40, the gross margin was 60, A&P was 10, sales and distribution expenses were about 45%, G&A was about 17, G&A is general administration, 17, and we made a loss of about 12%. IFO is income from operation, PBT is profit for tax. Now, what are the strategic choices that the company had? We could offer better quality, we could offer better experience, we could, if we could command a higher price, or we could go down and say, listen, let's reduce the pricing, let's reduce the quality, let's go everywhere. Those are the strategic choices we had. Now, we could say, look, if we are going down, we will sell more volume, we will have sourcing and manufacturing efficiency. But if we were going up the ladder of premiumization, then we will have to bring about certain innovations. A&P, you know, we could actually just say, look, if you go to a shopper stop over a store there, Shopper Stop will have to invest into getting the consumer to know Shopper Stop, and anybody who comes in there will buy my product as well. So do I want to do that, or I want to create my own stores and provide a compelling experience to the consumer? So these are the kind of choices that we had to make, and we made those choices. This is the outcome after 2 years that Mr. Call was talking. So from minus 12%, the business saw a swing of 25%. So the business got to being from an underperformer in a tough industry, became an outperformer in a tough industry. What are the kind of things we did? We improved the quality of merchandise. You know, there were certain actions. First and foremost, for example, we were sourcing cotton, which is what the polo shirt is made from. We were sourcing it from Coimbatore, some good quality cotton. But you know what? Lacoste shirts globally are made from the finest quality Puma cotton. You know what? We will get that cotton. We imported that cotton, we made everything. And we were not doing it in India. resin treatment is a very, very complicated process. It is not easy to do. We had to make serious investments in that. But we took a decision of saying, look, Lafarge globally is known as a polo shirt brand. Why are we trying to make trousers? Why are we trying to make pajama? We were doing all kind of things. We said, look, let's make the best polo shirt in the world. That's what Lafarge is. That's what, let's make it in India. So we'll play in that category, but that category will be second to none. So we invested into resin treatment. Post doing resin treatment, we could make the same promise of color stability, dimensional stability, color fastness, everything that are global. Last but not least, we created a store experience in a manner that whether you walked into a New York store with the venue, or you walked into the Champs-Élysées store in Paris, or you walked into Tokyo store in Japan, or you walked into the South Extension store in Delhi, blindfolded, you will not be able to tell which part of the world it is. The consumer experience and planogram has to be the same. These are the things that we did. I heard that this was the game plan. They implemented it. And we'll talk about implementation in a short while from now when we get to that stage. But the results are for you to see. You know, a swing like this, and we became the best performer, and returning a capital, a return on capital is about 30%, and 20% return on capital was considered good. You know, we were returning 30% return on capital employed, and our sales to FA, we were really sweating our assets, was in the region of 4. So that is how you look at the choices available to a firm and win it, win the game that way. Now, this is what we had to say about the industry. Now, we have to come back to clearer task of the strategy. So I want to declutter the strategy for this group. Who is the consumer? You know, that we are trying to, whatever we are doing, whether we are flying, whether we are making cars, whether we are making rockets, whether we are driving aeroplanes, whatever we are doing, who is it for? And why is my offer better and more attractive than anybody else? What is it that makes my offer better? Right? And how? Why will my others will copy it? If my offer is better, others will also copy it. So what is it that I will do which will make my offer better and it will keep it better? You know, so I've taken an example of an airline. Now, this is the time when, you know, look at the airline history of India. Air India has been there forever, and it's always been using, always dependent on the government support. You would recall that the airline that actually came in the 90s, and from the 90s till 2010, it was the gold standard of airline, the Jet Airways, and we all know which way it went. You know, it went bankrupt. In between, Kingfisher came, Kingfisher got bankrupt. Who else came? There was an airline called Deccan Airline. You know, it got merged with Sahara. Sahara went into Jet, and Jet went bankrupt. So airline is an industry. And if you recall some of the slides back, I told you that airline is a tough industry. So there is something wrong that was happening in the airline industry. But then comes IndiGo. And IndiGo has not only attained scale, it has attained profitability, and it has gone about it in a very, very scientific manner. And therefore, it's a good idea to see what was their strategy and why it has worked for them, and why is it continuing to work. So I've taken the IndiGo example, and this is what it looks like. What did IndiGo do? Who did they target? They target two sets of consumers. They said non-players, people who were going from Delhi to Mumbai in the Adani Express, and they were paying a fare of, second AC fare was about 3,000 rupees. They said, in 3,000 rupees, I will reach you in a plane in 2 hours' time from Delhi to Mumbai. So they targeted these people first. The other people that they target, and the typical fare of that time for an economy class was about 6.5 to 7. If you went Jet Airways, if you went Indian Airlines, any of those airlines, the typical fare will be between 6,000 and 7,000. IndiGo started doing it at about 4,000. So they also weaned away consumers from other airlines. So they said, look, there will be enough people who are willing to pay a couple of thousand extra for saving a lot of time and saving a lot of inconvenience of traveling in a train. So they targeted non-flyers who were taking a train to point-to-point destinations. And they also targeted people who were dissatisfied with the pricing of the full-service airlines like Jet Airways and Kingfisher and others. What did they offer? They offer very timely. What was their promise? I remember that I used to take IndiGo because other flights were invariably getting delayed. IndiGo will take off on time, IndiGo will land up. If I plan my three meetings in Mumbai, one near Santa Cruz Airport, second at Andheri, and the third at town, I will be able to do those three meetings and get back home by the last flight. So time had value for me. It was no frills, and therefore it was low price. Now, how did they offer low price? Because they offered low cost. If your cost is low, then you can price yourself low. How did they attain that cost leadership? Let's look at a series of things that they did. They went to cheaper airport. In India, in Delhi, for example, they continued to work out of Palam. They refused to go to T3. At T3, when they were forced to go to T3, they chose to still go with the ladders rather than aerobridge, because aerobridge is more expensive. And for the entry gates, they went to the last gates, not the first gate. You fly Vistara, you know, you walk two steps and you are at the exit. You fly IndiGo from T3, you need to go all the way, walk for 20 minutes before you get to T3. But they save money there. What do they do? You would also see that their air hostesses actually clean up the plane before it lands. What does it do? They turn around the plane. A plane will make money only if it's in air. If it is on the ground, it is going to lose money. A lot of planes of Air India are actually in the hangars. So if you have a car which is standing in a hangar, like what is happening in Uber, why Uber to disrupt the car industry? That is because the car belongs to the road, it should run. Right? Our cars, you know, all of us have 2-3 cars, all of them are standing in the garage all the time. So that is the reason. So their turnaround time was 15 minutes. In 15 minutes, the 15-20 minutes, the plane they have to offload, another 15 minutes, they could reload the plane. In 30 minutes, they were back in air. They got preference from the ATC because they paid a premium that, look, I'm going to pay you a premium for sure. I'll keep my time, but you give me a clearance to fly on that time. They did corporate deals. Very importantly, they kept single type of plane. You know, single type of plane, they did not have to worry about inventory, they did not have spare parts, they did not have to worry about training, they did not have to have very strong bargaining power with the plane supplier. Employees were engaged because the company was winning and therefore the employees were engaged, so therefore employees did not have them. Therefore, they did not have to train new employees. Right? They offered no frills. There is still no loyalty program that IndiGo offers. They offer some meals, packaged meals, but they have to buy them, and there are no lounges. But they get you cheapest, they get you on time. Right? And there is no business class. Everything is one economy. That is what works. Very fine example of a beautiful strategy, beautiful execution, and winning. So that's an example I thought I'll give you on what are the pillars of strategy and how to go about it. Making it, and one example of who's done it well. You must think about more of who have done similar things well. Now, there are a lot of people who have actually created a scale. For example, Baiju has created a scale in the industry. You know, but are they making money? Do they have a path to profitability? Amazon has made a lot of scale. Flipkart made a lot of scale, and the promoters made a lot of money. But is the business model proven? The business model is not proven as yet. In case of IndiGo, the scaling is happened based on a proven business model. That's the beauty of that strategy. The next ladder, because we have another just 10-15 minutes left, and therefore I'll have to kind of rush through some of these things. But the next leg of a strategy is execution. And I wouldn't really dive too much into execution today for a long time. However, you need to look at even for execution, and I'll take a COVID example. Right? So there, it's a 5F framework that I normally deploy. It's a framework that I started deploying maybe 20 years ago and have stayed with it because it has always worked for me. Future, so first and foremost, we have to create a compelling vision of what I try to do. So currently, we are all sitting at home because of COVID. Now, what did our Prime Minister do on the 23rd of March? He came to the national television, and he bought us a clarity that this is what COVID can do. And we are going to be out for 3 weeks, sitting at home. We are going to be cooperating with each other, and we are feeling he created a vision, very, very compelling for all of us to follow. And that was the first step of execution. When you have to execute, he realized that, you know, we don't have adequate kits to test. We don't have enough hospital beds. We don't have enough ventilators. And therefore, we had to curtail the cycle. People, how can you stop 130 million people, 130 crore people to be actually not coming out of the house? You have to get up there and give a speech which everybody looks up to and buys it. That's what you do. So that is the future. You have to sell a future. Few other examples in business of people who have been able to sell a future. If you have read about Tesla, you know, Tesla is something that Elon Musk actually sold the vision of a Tesla car. And of course, everybody knew that an EV will be a good thing. It will not be polluting the environment. It will be great. However, will it get me the thrill of this speed? Will it give me a tank to travel 500 miles? Will I get a refill somewhere else? Till such time that he sorted those issues out, it was not going to sell. Today, he has been able to do that. And at least in some parts of the world, some parts of the US, it has attained, Tesla has become the most valuable car company in the world. And that's because of a compelling vision that is there. I can give many more examples, but so can you think. So I think it's a good idea for you to think. For beginning of execution of a good strategy, you need to have a future that you are playing to. Second is the focus. You know, in terms of focus, some assumptions, you know, we focused, again, to take a COVID example. We stayed at home for the first half. We went through all the problems in the first lockdown. Then the second lockdown came, then the third lockdown came. And now we have all kind of issues. Some people feel that we've been able to control it. Some people are saying that, where did we go wrong? So probably we focused only on one aspect. We focused on one aspect of it. We don't want a lot of people to die from it. Did we focus on adequate number of aspects? Probably not. The example that I was giving you on the cost was that you need to look at various aspects of the business. You cannot focus on one aspect. And it is an optimization exercise for those who understand, you know, linear programming. It's a optimization exercise. It is not a maximization exercise. So you need to think of various things important, such as displacement of migrant laborers. Now, we did not focus on that at that time. Therefore, we did not measure it, which is the fourth F, feedback. We did not measure it. What you measure will get done. What you don't measure will not get. If you had thought that there will be so many people will get displaced and they will be going home because that's where they will be comfortable, we did not focus on that. Therefore, we did not measure it, and therefore we have a miss. Factors, you know, innovation is something that the world around us is getting disrupted. I want to give you a Kohler example. You know, it's very funny, how do you create innovation? So in Kohler, we were into kitchen and bath. I remember, you know, there was these people called, there's a discipline called ethnography. Ethnography are people who observe consumers in their daily life and come up with new products. One example I want to give you is, so we went with these ethnographers to a consumer's kitchen, and she was working in her kitchen when we were allowed to sit by her. We were allowed to sit in her kitchen and observe her. And we came up with a new product, which is actually a faucet that you can actually pull out of a socket in a kitchen basin, wash the nearby area, and pull it back in. Now that product, where did the insight come? Because the housewife was actually washing up the utensils in the kitchen basin, and then taking a mug, putting in water, and with a broom, she was cleaning the area around. And it was very messy. I was also sitting there. I did not think that way I could think a new product out of that. But this research discipline could actually think of a new product out of it. We came up with a product which is a huge global success. Today, you even go to a bar, they actually pull out, you know, that faucet from a socket and fill up your mug with draft beer. So that has become ubiquitous now, everywhere. So that is how you innovate. You always continue to research, find out new consumer insights, and keep doing it. Last part of the execution is flexibility. Irrespective of what plan you make, things will go wrong. They will go wrong, and you need to have a way of coming back to to the park. Therefore, you need to be always on the ball. I'll give you an example of that. Today, for example, we are finding that there is a lot of migrant labor which is going on, creating misery, and that is not what we want to do. Are we taking corrective actions? Of course. So now there are trains being run, there are buses being run, there is a testing protocol being put in place, there is quarantines being put in place. That is flexibility. If you continue to stay rigid, that, you know, no, I'm not going to change my strategy, then it becomes a little difficult. It will cause people not to win. And winning means, which is my next slide, that the end result is to win. You know, and win in the context of a business, consumers, you need to have the current consumers, you need to track it, that do I have consumers who are coming? Am I able to actually increase my customer base? One of the things that I always measure, am I expanding my customer base or not? Am I retaining my current consumer and deepening their engagement? These are two important KPIs that I always track in every business that I have. Customers are the intermediaries. So if I have a distributor, if I have a converter, you know, if I have a supplier, you know, I need to see whether, you know, he is making ROI or not, and whether he is seeking business out of my business or is he dissatisfied with it. For suppliers, I want to see whether I am going to upgrade him or not. Because let's say if it is a small time supplier who is making converting my notebooks in Aurangabad, you know, am I bringing him new techniques? Am I supporting him with new technology? Am I getting him new, you know, thoughts in the mind? Am I upgrading him or not? Society, I talked about renewable forestry. For environment, I talked about engaging farmers to grow trees with which we will make all other products. Firm, you know, it is the company, you need to be constantly monitoring your market share, top of mind for your brand and free cash flows. This is what I measure to see whether all stakeholders are winning or not. Employees, am I having longer tenures with my employees, or am I have a churn in my employee base? If a lot of people are seeking better careers outside my company, outside my organization, then obviously I'm not doing a good job of engaging. Am I giving them careers? You know, one of the things that I write on my CV is, how many people who work with me have gone on to become CEOs and have actually done better than I have? So they contribute to my success and I contribute to their success. It's a very, very powerful symbiotic relationship that we need to make with our employees and our colleagues. Last but not least, shareholders. If shareholders are not happy, you heard Mr. Paul talked about, you know, bring about the management change. You don't want to be changed because of low performance. Shareholders need to get, you know, total shareholder returns. Total shareholder returns, in simple terms, is the dividends that they get and the increase in the share price that they get, the valuation of the company. They look at the total shareholder returns. If you're not giving it to them better than what they can get elsewhere, you know, they will think about management change. It's not a good idea. The visual on the side shows that, you know, any link, any weak link out of all these is something that results into unhappiness situation. So this is all I have to say. I think it is 6 o'clock, and I will end my presentation here.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. On behalf of all the students and faculty members and the management team, we thank you so much. Such a tough subject, you explained in a very simple way. Even the definition was very simple. Definition in the sense, you said strategy is plan with a focus on execution and to win. Rightly said, it's like a game. Game is played only to win. Strategy is there to win the game. And you explained everything, taking into account your entire experience. And examples you took from the day-to-day household things. You talked about kitchen, ethnography, and ethnographers, and you explained the concept so nicely that even the students who are yet to join the college, they understood it. Then you talked about certain things which were mentioned in the last lecture also, like purple cow and now these phrases, etc., are solidly embedded in our minds and in our heart, and so that we shall be using them so often in our discussions. I keep telling my students that discussion, what you have, should show that you are management students. And similarly, you mentioned a different type of graph to our students, which was a new thing, showing three parameters on one graph, like x-axis, y-axis, two parameters were shown, and the third parameter was shown by the size of the circle. And students will find this in Excel also. This is called balloon graph. So you talked about so many things in such a simple way that we have understood almost completely. Thank you so much. Even say, you talked about execution, plan, etc. You mentioned five F's, and we have understood, and my students have also understood. Thank you so much, sir. Once again, sparing your precious time for us. Thank you so much.